Rest. You know, number seven is the number of rest, right? Seven is the number of rest. Now we are now living in the beginning of the seventh day. All right? Or the third beginning of the third day from Jesus. Seven is the number of rest. And it's used, that word rest, or peace and rest, is used 54 times in the book of Revelation. It's an end time thing. And there are two major spirits that will stop you entering into rest. One is unbelief, and the other is fear. The Bible talks about men's hearts fearing because of the things that are coming on the face of the earth, right? Talked about that. But we are a people of God who have to walk in absolute rest and in peace, where 1,000 shall fall at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. And that kind of protection is only accomplished by walking in complete rest and peace in God. It's the beginning of tabernacles. It goes right through to the end of tabernacles. And it says, you know, fear and unbelief. The children of Israel could not trust God to get them into the promised land. They said it's too hard out there. The enemy's too strong. It was fear. And it was unbelief, and they went back into the wilderness and died there. We're right at that point, you know, the church is at that point. Some dreadful things are going to be happening. The Ebola outbreak, which came out of Nigeria, is tiny, tiny, small thing to what's going to hit this planet. And if we are not walking in absolute rest and absolute peace, we won't make it through. Peace is an incredible weapon. The enemy doesn't know what to do with it. And so we have to come to this place. Hebrews chapter 3 and verse 18. And to whom he swore that they would not enter into his rest, but to them that believed not. Because they couldn't believe that God would take care of them. Do you believe, no matter what's happening in the world for you, your children, your household, do you believe that God's going to take care of you? Yes. And if you die, it's okay? Yes. Come on. Some of you will die. You're older than me. If you're going to die, have a good death. Go out praising God and thanking him for a great life. But you know, fear and unbelief. Fear destroys the covering of God over us. Unbelief does the same thing. It destroys the covering that God can keep us in. And that's what happened. They couldn't enter into their promised rest because of fear and because of unbelief. Hebrews 3:19. So we see that they could not enter in because of unbelief. And that unbelief was rooted in fear. They did not believe God could or would protect them and take care of them. Coming to this place is really not easy. You know? You know, we say, well, I can come into rest if God would change my circumstances. Wrong. God cannot change your circumstances until he's been able to change you. And then your circumstances will change. You cannot overlook the fact that this rest was the major objective for the children of Israel. That was their promised land, a rest in God. And so it is for us. Joshua 1:13, remember the word which Moses, the servant of the Lord, commanded you, saying, the Lord your God hath given you rest and hath given you this land. Now let me say something. That land is inside of you. It's not some geographical place. It's inside you. And that's where the giants are. For you are not yet come into rest, and to the inheritance, Deuteronomy 12, 9, you are not yet come into rest, and to your inheritance which the Lord your God giveth you. Now Hebrews chapter 4 tells us that most of them did not make it, did not enter into rest because of unbelief. Rest was the first stage of the Feast of Tabernacles, and it continued on right through to the end. You know, to enter into rest, you must die. You know, when you're dead, you're at rest, right? Come on. Okay, spiritually, you cannot enter into rest until you die. To what you want, to your own self, to your own, all of these things. It's a state, it's a condition. Rest and peace has to dominate our lives. No matter what's going on in your family, your circumstances, in the world, we have to come into this place of rest. It's the first thing of the Feast of Tabernacles, where there's no more fear. And it's going to require a different level of consecration of our lives to reach this. See, every salvation required a certain level of consecration. Baptism of the Holy Spirit required a certain level of consecration. The Feast of Tabernacles and coming into rest requires another level of surrender and consecration to the Lord. We have to absolutely surrender to His and trust in His love and purpose for us. Whether we live or die is not the issue. We trust God. And entering into this rest puts a barrier over us to the outside. And it's really important that we grasp this. A new level of consecration is needed in order to enter the Feast of Tabernacles. See, Paul said this in the Philippians 1 and verse 20 and 21. He said, according to my earnest expectations and my hope, that in nothing I shall be ashamed, but that with boldness as always, so now with also Christ shall my be magnified in my body, whether it be by life or whether it be by death. Look, if you're going to go out before the Lord returns, let Christ be magnified in your body. Go out magnifying the Lord. Some of you won't make it because you'll die. You're old and just getting old, and you know what I mean. Let's be realistic. Go out that God is magnified in your body. I've seen a lot of people die, and I've seen some rotten deaths, and I've seen some glorious deaths. That's what he was talking about. He said, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. We should never be afraid of dying. Never. No matter how old or how young we are. Dying is a promotion. Hallelujah. You've gone up a peg, you know, being promoted. It's an inner state. We've got to make a level of consecration before the Lord that it does not matter what happens to us or our family or our kids. That doesn't mean we don't pray for them, but that we're in the Lord's hands, whether it's life or death. We have to come to the place where there's no fear in death. Some terrible things are going to happen across this world. You know, that typhoon hitting Japan at the moment is on a very high scale. God spoke to me about Japan just a few weeks ago. That my wife and I were talking about it the other day. The Lord spoke to me, and he said, Japan is going to receive some devastation that will have ripples around the world. and the Japanese stock exchange will be completely taken out in an earthquake. That will form a ripple right around the world. See, we're living in these days. And we need to walk through them without fear and in complete rest. God is in control of your life. That requires another level of dedication, consecration, laying your life down to the Lord. No matter what happens, I'm in your hands. I will serve you. I'll do my very best to do what you require of me, and I'll follow you. Whatever happens, I'm in your hands. Now, you walk in peace and you walk in rest. In the midst of incredible things that are happening across the world, this inner state, you see, of tranquility, it opens the heavens around you. We have to learn to lay our life down now. You know, the millennium age will soon be upon us, and Solomon's reign, the reign of Solomon, was a picture of the end time church, but particularly for the millennium, you know, reign of Christ. Solomon wasn't perfect, but his reign was a foreshadow of the coming kingdom age. And it was an age of peace. You know, there were no wars during the time of Solomon. It was an age of rest, and it was an age of peace. David couldn't build this temple because he lived in a time when there were wars all around, and Israel was fighting and there was much bloodshed. He couldn't build it because it was a picture. Solomon's temple was a picture of the end time church and the millennium reign of Christ. And it was an age of peace. When Solomon dedicated the temple, guess what? It was on the Feast of Tabernacles. Entering into rest. An age of rest. And it said, then the glory of the Lord came down, and the priests couldn't stay on their feet to minister. Such was the impact. But it is of great significance that he dedicated the temple during the Feast of Tabernacles. Now we're here. We're right at that stage again. We're into the Feast of Tabernacles. You see, how can I explain this? We're coming into the millennium, which is an age of peace and rest. But it can only be inhabited by Christians who have already learned to walk in that peace and rest. Listen to me. Enoch told me this. He said, you will not get in unless you're walking in peace and rest, because that's the nature of the millennium reign of Christ. And everything that will be built, the architecture, everything, will be a reflection of the inner state and life of the people in the millennium. See, not everybody is going to be in the millennium. God's not going to empty out heaven and bring them all to earth for the millennium. You've got to qualify for the millennium reign of Christ. And you will never get into it without you walking in peace and rest, because that's the initial qualification for the millennium. It's an age of peace and rest, the seventh day. See, we're talking about internally, you have to come into rest. Very hard, particularly when things are going wrong. But we have to come into this point where handing over the reins to the Lord, because he is in charge. We'll do what he asks us to do, but he's initially and finally in charge. And learning to walk in that is not as easy as it sounds. You see, we have this inner battle going on all the time. This thing goes wrong. Why did this happen? This, I wish things were better here. That's the giants on the inside. That's the giants keeping you out of the promised land. You've got to kill them. You've got to stop and say, no. I'm going to be responsible for what God requires of me, but I'm not going to fear. And I'm going to walk at rest, trust him with my life, my circumstances, my kids, my career, everything. And two, that inner battle comes to an end. See, there's a battle on the inside. It goes on all the time. What if this? What if that? What if I don't get married? What if I don't find someone to marry? What about this? What if I'm going to die? What? The inner battle. If you can come into rest, the heavens will open above you. But it takes that. The heavens are going to open in the Feast of Tabernacles like never before. But the first thing we have to come into is rest. Let go and let God take the control. And it's a certain level of commitment now that God requires of us, that you have to make before the Lord. You have to go before the Lord and have this out with Him. Lay it all down. A new age of glory and rest and peace is coming, but it will be built and governed by people who've learned to enter into that rest and peace within their own hearts first. To qualify for the millennium, you first have to, in this life, come into a state of rest. Because the millennium is 1,000 years of rest. Seventh day. Your mind has to come into rest. Oh, man, your mind. The things that run over in your mind, right? You think about them. What can you do about it? What can you do? Well, you probably can't do anything. So stop it. Shut it down and say, God, I trust you. And you're going to have to do this a dozen times or more before you finally settle into it and say, yes, okay, I'm going to walk in this rest and in this peace in God. Your life will change. It really will change. You know, Solomon's reign was characterized by wisdom and revelation and knowledge, right? The wisdom, he had the wisest man that ever lived. He built an incredible reign of Christ, incredible reign of peace, which extended a great. When you look at what Solomon did and the chariots he had, the horses he had, the wealth he had, all of this he had, it was an incredible time, but it only could be achieved if they were walking in rest and peace. And he dedicated the temple on the Feast of Tabernacles. Oh. See, if we learn to walk in this, we come into rest. The striving stops. The mind battles cease. And we come into rest. Then revelation starts to flow. Wisdom starts to come, like in the reign of Solomon. Great wisdom will start to come. Show you what to do, how to do it, where you are. But it cannot be achieved unless you're at rest. This is really, really important that we understand this. You know, very important. Satan, you know, was given great wisdom, but he fell. The reason he fell was ambition, pride, and fear. All that ambition, that pride, is going to be laid to rest. Give it away. It's not worth it. You know, it says of Lucifer in Ezekiel 28, verse 3, at least a picture of Lucifer. Behold, you are wiser than Daniel, says, and there is no secret that they can hide from you. But because of his fear, his ambition and fear, he fell. You see, that inner peace and rest is the inner promised land. Oh, hallelujah. See, the earth will become a paradise again because of the hearts of God's people who enter the millennium. It's already become a paradise. Is your heart a paradise? See, it's the inner person, the inner you, coming into rest. You know, Daniel 12 and verse 4 says, "But thou, Daniel, shut up the words and seal the book even to the end times. Many shall run to and fro in the end times, and knowledge shall increase." You know, God's got a lot more to tell us. He's got a lot more understanding to give us. We know even just a tiny little piece of God's purposes. Tiny. Tiny. We know we see salvation getting to heaven and maybe the millennium will come. A tiny piece of God's purposes. He said, shut up the words, but in the end times, knowledge shall increase. Understanding shall come. The book shall be opened to us. You know this word of God? The Bible says that the word of God is washed seven times. There are seven layers to the word of God. Seven levels of understanding to the word of God. We see just a tiny bit. But layer after layer, there's further light, further understanding, further revelation. Hallelujah. You see, it says in Hebrews 1:2, God hath in these last days spoken unto us by his Son, whom he hath anointed, appointed heir of all things, by whom he made the worlds, plural, whom he made the world. Its word is cosmos, which means ordered society. Not just one world, worlds. And through faith we understand that the worlds were framed by the word of God. He spoke them into being. And it says in Luke chapter 1, 33, and he shall reign over the house of Jacob forever, and of his kingdom there shall be no end to it. You see, we've always thought, getting to heaven, it's the end. Getting into the millennium, then it's the end. No, it is just the beginning. Not the end, it's the beginning. God hasn't finished. We all live happily ever after. He's going to extend his kingdom to the far reaches of this universe. Hey, is your goldfish bowl getting a bit bigger? So you can grow into it? Ephesians 3:21, unto him glory in the church by Jesus Christ. Listen, throughout all ages, worlds without end. Insight into God's plans and purposes, into the millennium and beyond. We need to enter into rest to access these kinds of levels of revelation and understanding. And the kind of anointing that God wants to bring in the Feast of Tabernacles, because it is greater than Pentecost, we have to enter into a whole new level of rest for that anointing to work through us. It's no longer us. You know, it's a total rest. You see, I'm standing here today, and people say, do you get, you know, how do you preach? Do you get nervous? No, I'm not nervous. I'm completely at rest and I'm enjoying talking to you. I've learned that. Learned it. I remember when we came out of Bible school and we had to preach at different places and go to different churches for an examination, you know? And the first thing I did in this, when it was my test in this church, I leaned on the pulpit and pushed it right off the stage onto the ground. I flopped on the first try. We can't achieve anything unless we come into rest. You can't flow in revelation. See, as I'm standing here, more and more understanding and revelation is coming to me, but simply I'm relaxed. I'm at rest. And that's how it works. Oh, hallelujah. We're going to build a new world at rest and peace. Deuteronomy 12:9 says, but you have not yet, as yet, come into your rest. Which means we can't fully come into our inheritance. See, it's the enemy within. That's the problem. All those giants in the promised land are in here and they're in here. They're in our mind. They're in our fears. They're in our emotions. They're in our mindsets. The giants have to be knocked off, dealt with. One of the biggest giants is fear. Fear of failure, fear of what people think of us, fear of man. If just that one barrier came down, we'd be totally different people. Just the fear of man, what people think of us. It would open up a whole new realm of God for us. Entering into rest. The enemy within. Oh. You know, the Bible tells us about being the branch. We are, Jesus is the vine, we are the branch, right? But, you know, way back in Isaiah's day, in Isaiah 4, verse 5, it says, the Lord will create in every dwelling place on Mount Zion and upon her assemblies a cloud and a smoke by day, a shining fire by night, and for all the glory shall be for a defense. Then in Isaiah 4:2, in that day, what day? That day, the branch of the Lord will be beautiful. Now, you know, Jesus walked this earth, and he was the branch, the Father was the vine. He was never hurried. I mean, we live in an age, you know, where everything is hurried unless you're in Manila traffic, then it's very slow. But you know, everybody's in a hurry. Everybody wants to get things done. Jesus never hurried. He refused to hurry. Because that's going to wreck something on the inside of us. We're going to lose our rest and we're going to lose our peace. So he said Jesus was a branch of his Father, just the branch. He wasn't the vine. And he said, I only do those things which I see the Father doing. That's a rest, I tell you. He was just the branch bearing the fruit. He wasn't in charge. The vine was in charge. But later, Jesus said, I am the vine. And guess who are the branches? You are. The branch really doesn't do much but bear fruit, you know. The main structure of that tree is the trunk and the roots, which is Jesus. And he says, if you abide in me, my words abide in you, you'll ask what you will and it shall be given. How many of you know how hard it is to abide in the Lord? Maybe for a few times during the day. But then something goes wrong at work or something goes wrong at home and our abiding has just disappeared. Our awareness and consciousness of the Lord is gone. Where did he go? No, he didn't go. You went. He said, I am the vine. You are the branches. You know, Jesus didn't move in the gifts of the Spirit. That might shock you. He moved in the seven spirits of the Lord, which were a permanent operation, not a fleeting here, there, this, there, that. It says in Isaiah 11, verse 1, and there shall come forth a rod out of the stem of Jesse, a branch shall grow out of his roots, talking about Jesus coming forth out of the stem of Jesse. And it said of this person who is just the branch, he's in complete rest. It says in Isaiah 11:2, and the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom, understanding, the spirit of counsel, the spirit of might, the spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord, etc. Seven different anointings would rest upon him. Now, see, we've got a candlestick here. Represents the seven spirits of the Lord. You know? And he said these seven spirits rested upon Jesus. It wasn't hard work for him. The seven spirits of the Lord rested upon him. Not just he had a word of knowledge now and again, or the word of prophecy. It was permanent. It was permanent with him. The seven spirits will rest upon this branch. See, if you're going to have the seven spirits of the Lord, you've got to be at rest. The branch is at rest. It's not doing the work. It's not supplying the food. It's not supplying anything. It's just a rest. Revelation 1 verse 4. John, to the seven churches which are in Asia, grace be unto you and peace unto him from which is and which was and which is to come, and from the seven spirits which are before his throne. There are seven spirits of the Lord before the throne of God. They sit there. Revelation chapter 4 verse 5. And out of the throne proceeded lightning, thundering voices, and there were seven lamps burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of the Lord. Seven lamps, they give off light. They give off different color. Okay. Revelation 4:2. And immediately I was in spirit, and behold, the throne was set in heaven, and one sat upon the throne, and he that sat was to look upon like jasper and a sardine stone, and there was a rainbow of seven colors above the throne. The rainbow about the throne, seven colors. Seven spirits of the Lord. Those seven spirits were given names way back in Isaiah's time. He said, you know, he said, and the spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him. That's one of the anointings, the spirit of the Lord. That's a prophetic anointing. And the spirit of wisdom, understanding, counsel, might, spirit of knowledge, and the fear of the Lord. And these things shall make him quick to understand things in the fear of the Lord. And he shall not judge anything by what he sees with the sight of his eyes, neither reprove with the hearing of his own ears. See, he was completely connected to the Lord, and he saw things as they were because of these seven spirits. Seven surrounded by a rainbow of seven colors. Now, there are literally seven spirits before the throne. I have seen them. There are seven spirits before the throne, seven colors, each carrying a specific anointing. Now, they don't leave there, but under them, there are spirits with their same nature. There are spirits of wisdom. They're not as high ranking as the ones before the throne, but under these spirits before the throne, these angelic beings, there are spirits under them with that same nature, spirits of the fear of the Lord and fear of knowledge, wisdom, all those things. And it says the eyes of the Lord, these eyes of the Lord, seven eyes of the Lord, are running throughout the whole earth to find those on whom they can rest. This is Feast of Tabernacles, you see. This is what it's all about. They're discerned by color. You see, there's a color here today, just, it is red in color. That red is the Spirit of the Lord, Jesus said, is upon me, because he has anointed me prophetically to preach. And the Spirit of the Lord is red. It's a red color through here. There's more than one color. And there's also orange, which is the Spirit of wisdom. But, you know, the Spirit of wisdom, when that is in manifestation, there's a color in the realm of the Spirit over the place. That's what these angels emanate. That wisdom has a color. Spirit of understanding. That's the next color of the rainbow down, yellow. These are spirits which emanate light in color. And the spirit of counsel, which is green, the color green of the rainbow. The spirit of might, which is blue. You know, Samson, even in the Old Testament, the spirit of might rested upon Samson. Incredible, powerful thing. And the spirit of might also rested upon David's mighty men. You know, you get one guy who can kill 1,000 men in one day. That's the spirit of might. David's mighty men, that spirit rested upon him. We're going to have the spirit of might come upon us in times when there are earthquakes and you're going to lift stones off people as if you were the biggest crane in the universe. You're going to pull these people out and then heal them. These are the seven anointings of the Spirit. This is beyond Pentecost. This is the Feast of Tabernacles. The spirit of counsel, green. The spirit of might, which is blue. The spirit of indigo, which is the spirit of knowledge. Spirit of the fear of the Lord, which is violet. You can discern what's happening in a meeting by discerning the color of what is present. You remember the guy by the name of Charles Finney? He had one of these angels, the spirit of the fear of the Lord, that went with him everywhere he went. And it made him so easy for him. He gets on a tram car and everybody starts repenting. He hasn't opened his mouth. What happened? Well, this angel's here with him. The spirit of fear of the Lord. You'd repent too. He goes into a factory with his friend. And the whole factory stops. Because this angel's with him. This mighty spirit, fear of the Lord, is with him. And the fear of the Lord come upon the people in the factory and start getting saved. See? Oh, hallelujah. This is our heritage in the Feast of Tabernacles. It says in Zechariah 3 and verse 8, it says, "Hear, O Joshua, the high priest, and thou and your fellows that sit before you, they are men to be wondered at." Why? "For I'll bring forth my servant, the branch." You see, if we can become the branch and come under the seven spirits of the Lord, anything is possible. But you've got to be at rest for this to happen. The agitation. You know, some of our lives, it's like living in a goldfish bowl with all the sand in the bowl stirred up. You can't see anywhere. You can't discern anything. All the sand is stirred up. You go stop and let the sand settle. Come into rest. Come into peace. Then you can see. Then you can understand. The spirits of the Lord. This rest, you know, is remarkable in Jesus because he did only what he saw the Father doing. And in order to do that, he had to be able to see what the Father was doing. And if we're going to come into that place of seeing what the Lord is doing, we have to be in absolute rest. The sand has to drop to the bottom so we can see. The turmoil has to cease. The fear has to be dealt with. See, Jesus went on to say, you know, we can walk the way he walked. He said in John 14, 20, verse 12, rather, "Verily I say unto you that he that believeth on me, the works that shall he do also, and greater works than I did, because I go to the Father." See, now we become the branch. And when we become a branch, anything's possible. Because it's not us anymore. You see? Oh, if you abide in me, as the branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can you do this until the striving stops, the battle on the inside stops, we come into rest, and we abide in him. You know the word in here, if you abide in me. In the Greek, there are 13 different words for the English word in. Now that makes it confusing, you know, the English word in. But the Greek word that's used here, if you abide in me, is a Greek word which means to remain in at rest. That's literally what it means. Never flustered. If you abide in me, remain in him at rest. What I see the Father do? See, spiritual awareness must be developed. You know, and if we're going to see and move in what God is saying and doing, spiritual awareness must be developed. You know, I had this experience in 2008. And I found myself standing on a sea of glass, right at the back. Well, to me it was the back, but there was a lot behind me. But there's myriads of stuff going on. There were angels, there were saints singing and dancing, there were angels everywhere. It was the sea of glass, you know, and it was like, and I just found myself standing there. And I could see the throne way, way down in the distance. But I had missed just 3 days of not being with the Lord, mainly because I've been busy with other things and all kinds of things, and I felt guilty now being in the presence of the Lord. And so I was quite happy to stand right at the back and just enjoy this, you know. I thought, well, this is good. And I was just enjoying this, and I heard this, Neville. I thought, no. Then I heard, come. I thought, that's worse. So I knew it was the Father. And I made my way through the saints and angels, slowly trying to figure out what I was going to say. Slowly, I got right down to the front, and I stood before the Father, and I said, what is it, Lord? He said, Neville, I've missed you. I thought, oh no, that's the worst thing I can hear. I was trying to comprehend how the Father could miss me. It had only been 3 days. I thought, Lord. And I was trying to take all of this in, still feeling awkward and guilty. And he suddenly picked me up and pulled me inside himself. And I thought, I'm in God. And I was overwhelmed, because the main thing for God is his great love, you know. Then the thought came to me, I'm in the secret place of the Most High. And I thought, yes. And then I thought this, I thought, oh, the tabernacle was not just a picture of us, body, soul, and spirit, but it's a picture of God and heaven. Paradise is his outer court. I'm in the secret place. Then I had the strangest feeling. I felt that if I could move back a few hundred miles above from the throne room and the heaven, that the whole of heaven would be in the shape of a man. I mean, it was the weirdest perspective. I thought, wow. Jesus in God, heaven is his likeness and human form. Heaven is Christ in God. That was a vast place. I thought paradise was huge. But then it took me further out, way out. And I was looking beyond the universe. I was the other side of the universe, the known universe to create. And I was looking down, and the whole of the universe was in the shape of a man. I could only see it because I was so far away from it. And I thought, wow, God does fill heaven and earth. Heaven and earth. The whole of hell is also in the shape of a man. There are arms, people in the head, heart, depending. And I thought, wow, this is the power of revelation. I thought, you know. Then I became aware of John chapter 14, verse 23. Jesus answered and said unto him, if a man love me, he will keep my words, and my Father will love him, and we will come into him, or he will come into us, and we'll make our abode with him. I became then aware of Jesus, and I became aware of the Father, and I are one. It's a reality. Then I heard the Lord look at me, and he said, when you are dead to self, you can live in me. I thought, that's enough for now, you know, because scriptures were running through my mind at the same time. Scriptures like, for you are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. All this was going on at the same time. I began to feel something of the heart of God. I became aware of God's incredible love for every human being, not just Christians, for every human being. I sensed also, it's hard to explain this, but I sensed there was a loneliness with God. He missed his family. There was a loneliness, a sense. I sensed his great desire for a family. I sensed the agony that with his that when Jesus was cut off from the Father, bearing the sin of the world, I sensed the agony of God. All this happened very quickly. And I sensed then his anticipation of receiving many sons in a great family. You see, then Jesus looked at me and he said, revelation and awareness turns the shadow into reality. And the reflection becomes a reality. He said, what you are seeing and experiencing is real, but you must learn to walk in it. At that point, I saw the earth, and it was a small globe. I was looking down on the earth from where I was, and the thought went through my mind, how could I be there and here at the same time? You know, you think these things. You know, as the moment I thought that, a scripture went through my mind, John 3:13, and no man ascended up into heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son of Man which is in heaven. I thought, that is weird. So, you know, no man hath ascended to heaven, but he that came down from heaven, even the Son which is in heaven. Jesus walked in two realms at the same time. He was on earth and he was in heaven. That's what this scripture is saying. Now I was back in my room. You see, there are places where God wants to take us. Oh, if we can come into rest. You know, revelation, which changes knowledge into truth and experience. And it's important, you know, that we learn to flow in these things. How do we enter into rest? Well, the Bible talks about ceasing from our own works. Hand over the reins of your life. You say, well, I've done this before. Yes, but that was at Pentecost. There's another level than our consecration which God requires of us all. Another depth of laying down our life and handing over the reins. And if we start to make these in the days that we have left and before the next blood moons in 215, the grace in God will be with us to begin to walk in this. You know? It's a process. Entering into rest is a process. Ceasing from your own works. It's one test after another to overcome fear. and unbelief and walk in rest. God will allow things to happen in your life which is going to test you in the realm of fear. He'll let it happen to you so that you'll learn to say, no, I'm not going to fear this. God is in control. I don't care what happens. I trust you, Lord, and I come into rest because I know you love me and all things work together for good to them that love God. You pass the test and it's established in your heart. You'll go through this many times and eventually the battle on the inside stops. And there's no more fear. It'll be test after test after test. And it's his way of bringing us into this whole thing. Passing the tests. You'll face circumstances completely out of your control. And so the only thing you can do is come into rest and hand it all over to God. That establishes it a bit further in your life. You have to overcome these things. Different level of surrender to God. Entering into rest. We've got time, you know, to make between now and the end of the next set of blood moons to get before the Lord and say, Lord, I want to make my consecration on another level now. I want it to be adequate enough to enter into the Feast of Tabernacles. I want to take it to another level. You'll go through some things, you know, to test you on this, you know, but that's all right. If you walk in peace, the devil cannot do anything with you. He doesn't know what to do with peace. It baffles him. He can't touch you because you're walking in peace. Think it not strange concerning the fiery trials, which, you know, as if some strange thing is happening to you. You're going to have trials. Listen to me. If you're going to be an overcomer, you have to have something to overcome. So, be prepared for trials. You know, Joe and I never made it here. 2 weeks ago, I was on the verge of sending an email. I was going to send it to Nona. I didn't dare send it to Brother Dan. That we can't come because we were so sick. So sick. I mean, really sick. And usually I'm pretty good at fighting through, you know, stuff like that. But this, we're really sick. And I thought, Lord, I've got to give them at least 2 weeks' notice. I can't give them notice the 2 days before the conference that I'm not coming. And I was in this thing, and I thought, oh, we've got to come to rest, you know. But it was a test, you know. I said to my son, Mark, you know, this is the situation. He said, I'm going to pray. So he came back to me and he said, Mark's my son. He said, I think you should go. Even if you're half dead, you should go. I felt worse than half dead. Tests. We go through them all the time. But it establishes us in these things in God. That's the way it works, you know. Once you've passed the test a few times, because we don't get it right the first time, you know. So you get to take it again. You know, until the nature of that aspect of the nature of God is established within you. You don't pass the test and they keep failing. You know, you go around the mountain another time. He said, you know, God might apply some discipline, but if that doesn't work, he'll just leave you where you are. We have to determine to go on in God. And then you live your life out in the lower plane if he takes his hand off it. You must learn to become sensitive. All right, we've got 5 minutes. Becoming sensitive to the Holy Spirit is really, really important now. Really important. If we're going to rest in the Lord, we've got to become sensitive to him. You know, and it's... We have to learn to walk, you know, with the Lord. And there are seven sensations of the spirit man, which are very, very important. And I'll run through them very quickly with you, because you have to learn them. I covered some of these in How to Walk with God. But the first sensation is to sigh. If you get up in the morning for no reason, you're like, there's a sigh coming from deep within. It may take you for a while to think, what am I doing that for? What is that? What's taking place within you? It says when Jesus prayed for a blind man, just before he prayed, he sighed. And he looked up to the heavens and he sighed, Mark 7:34, and said unto him, be opened. Jesus sighed. The Greek word for that word sigh is the Greek word stenazo, S-T-E-N-A-Z-O, which means to pray. There's a burden, and it's a call as a prayer burden. Your sigh is an indication of your spirit that's coming under a burden to pray. But for that to reach the mind, in order for us to do it, we have to recognize it. It's a sensation that appears in your spirit, generated by the Holy Spirit, and usually it's a signal you need to go somewhere and pray. And a burden to pray often comes when you find yourself sighing. And you don't, and there's no reason for it. You think, why am I doing that? You know, Mark 8:12, it says, and he sighed deeply in his spirit, Jesus. It's the same word, stenazo. He sighed deeply in his spirit. We need to learn to recognize that when it is happening. When it's easy to pray, it's because this stenazo, this sensation of in our spirit is being triggered by the Holy Spirit. We need to recognize that and deal with it. Go and pray. Did you ever wake in the night with, or during the day with this sensation, you know, of a sigh? God's knocking on your door. He said, hey, wake up. I talked to you. You need to pray. There's a prayer burden in your spirit now. Let it hit your consciousness and your emotions. There's a prayer burden here. Work with me. Stenazo. There's a Hebrew equivalent of that in Ezekiel 21:6, where it says, sigh therefore, thou son of man, with the breaking of your loins. And he's talking about prayer. It's a spirit sensation that you have to learn to recognize. There is another spirit sensation, which is to groan. You know, it's different to the sigh. It says in Jesus, in John 11:33, when Jesus therefore saw her weeping, and the Jews also weeping which came to her, he groaned in his spirit, not in his mind or his emotions or his physical. He groaned in his spirit, eventually made his way through his emotions and his consciousness, but he groaned in spirit. And again in John 11:38, Jesus therefore groaning in himself came to the grave, the cave, with a stone laid upon it. The Greek word here is the word embrimeomai. It's a Greek word which means to be, how can I put this, infused with authority and a sense of indignation for what the devil is doing. You mean that? It's a sensation to be infused with indignation and authority comes with it for what you see the devil doing, or what something's happening in a person's life. It's a mix of anger and authority, the good anger. And I'm sure some of you have experienced that at times, but you haven't recognized, you know, that again, it's a call to deal with this. It can trigger off the gift of faith, great miracles. In this case, when he sighed, he raised the person from the dead. There's this groan within him. Quickly now, thirdly, to be troubled in spirit. When Jesus had, in John 13:21, when Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in his spirit and testified, saying, verily, verily, I say to you that one of you shall betray me. He was troubled in his spirit. The Greek word for trouble here, trouble is a Greek word, terrazo, T-A-R-R-A-S-O. It means to be stirred, to agitate, because something is wrong. You know? This sensation can be so strong that it impacts you physically. You feel sick to your stomach. Because it works its way from your spirit through into your emotions in your physical body. But it's a sensation. It's troubled in spirit. Something's not right. It's a sensation. Feeling. It's like an inbuilt early warning system, you know? It operates ahead of time, giving you time to pray. Very important sensation to learn, and it can save you a lot of trouble. Let me cough. Bless you. It operates ahead of time, giving you time to pray. The many difficulties in your life can be avoided if you respond to this terrazzo, this trouble in your spirit, and go and pray. You remember, it's too late, you know, to close the stable door once the horse is bolted. It's too late to close the stable door. Once something's happened, it's too late, but you give time to pray to stop it from happening. You're troubled in your spirit. Jesus said, you know, in Luke 22, 31 and 32, the Lord said to Simon, Simon, behold, Satan have desired to have you, that he might sift you with wheat, but I have prayed for you, that your faith fail not. And when you are converted, you will strengthen many of your brethren. Jesus had this terrazzo, troubled in spirit about Peter. Something's not right, Peter. And he said, I've prayed for you. That's a sensation. Fourthly, to be provoked in your spirit. Acts 17:16. Now while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the whole city given to idolatry. This word stirred is the Greek word paroxyuno. And it means to be stirred and to be provoked in his spirit. It's a spirit sensation. It's kind of bordering on zeal, you know. And it's important to recognize that. When you start to get provoked in your spirit, it's a sensation. It's not a word. It's not a voice. It's a feeling. It's a sensation which originates in your spirit and registers with your emotions and your physical being. Provoked in spirit. Godly zeal. Fifth, to be pressed in your spirit. It says in Acts 18, verse 5, when Silas and Timothy were come from Macedonia, Paul was pressed in his spirit and testified to the Jews that Jesus was the Christ. This word pressed in it, you see, it's in his spirit, not in his soul. He was pressed in his spirit. It's a sensation of the spirit. And the Greek word is for pressed here is synecho. And it means to hold or press together, to become one with. Pressed in spirit is a spiritual sensation. It's hardly to explain. It's becoming consciously one with the Holy Spirit and his purpose and feeling. It carries the thought of being pressed into the Holy Spirit. And it's a very powerful manifestation of the Holy Spirit in your spirit. See, in 2 Corinthians 5 and verse 14, Paul said, for the love of Christ constrains me. Now, that's the same word. It's an echo. The love of Christ has pressed me into the Holy Spirit. The word constraineth. You know, you become so one with the Holy Spirit that you become invincible, you know, in the spirit. When Paul said in Acts, I go bound in spirit, Acts 20:22, he said, I go bound in spirit. It's the same word. I'm pressed into the Holy Spirit. I've become one with him. You know, he became invincible without fear. Acts 20:22 says, and I go bound in spirit to Jerusalem. He said, I know what's going to happen to me there. I go bound in spirit. Say, the Holy Spirit has witnessed in every city that bonds and afflictions are going to come. He said, and I go bound in spirit. It's the same words, then echo. He was pressed into this, became one with the Holy Spirit. He said, I don't care if I live or I die. I go bound in spirit. He had no fear at all. See, martyrs testify of this. It's a sensation. It's a feeling. Sixth, the other one, sixth, is the joy of the Lord. That's not happiness. It's a joy. That's spiritual. It's a Hebrew word which means a calm delight. It goes deeper than the emotions. Something that originates in your spirit, and it says the joy of the Lord is our strength. It's His joy within our spirit. It's a sensation. Colossians 1:11, strengthened with all might according to the glorious power unto all patience with joyfulness. And finally, the witness of the Spirit. Romans 8:16, the Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. The Greek word for witness here is a Greek word samarturio, and it means to bear witness to the truth. It operates as a check on your spirit or an affirmative in your spirit. You know, I was a really young Christian in my teens, people would say, do you get the witness of the Spirit? And I thought, well, I'm dumb, so I don't know. So I just said, yes. I thought, what's the witness of the Spirit? Is this something to do with the judge and you're the witness? Or what is this thing? I had no idea what they were talking about. I went along with them, but I had no idea, you know. It's a sensation in your spirit. The Spirit itself beareth witness with our spirit. It's a green light or a red light, you know. You bear witness, this is right or wrong. But it's a feeling. Not a word. It's a feeling. And you have to learn very quickly and how to cooperate with the Holy Spirit in this. It's time to walk in the Spirit. It's time to learn how to flow with Him. It's time to become more mature in sensing the realm of the Spirit with God. We're moving into a new level in the Feast of Tabernacles now. You cannot walk in this until you come into rest, and then you begin to sense these things very quickly. Let's just pray, shall we? Father, I just pray for every person here today. Lord, we all face new levels now of consecration and commitment to you. It's a new day. It's a new experience. It's entering into a new level, into the Feast of Tabernacles. And everything, every other thing in the Feast of Tabernacles hinges upon us first entering into rest. And so I pray for every person here today that they'll recognize when things go wrong and things are seemingly out of control, that it's an opportunity to finally stop and say, Lord, I trust you. Help me to trust you. I know you love me. All things work together for good for those who love God. I'm not going to let my rest and my peace disappear on this. I'm going to take a step back. And I'm going to come into rest on this. And you pass the test. I pray for them, Lord. Every person here on the point of entering into a new and level of experiencing God. Just as Passover was an experience of salvation. Just as Pentecost was an experience. Baptism of the Holy Spirit. We're entering into a new life experience now. In the Feast of Tabernacles. And there are many things in the Feast of Tabernacles which you've ordained that we walk in. That the seven spirits of the Lord will rest upon us. Lord, I pray for everyone. Give them a heart to follow after you, Lord, I pray. Let grace be upon them to help them into this. Grace. Let there be a willing and an open heart, Lord, to follow you, to not be left behind. In Jesus' name. Lord, let your hand and your peace be upon them today. Or ask them in the name of Jesus. Amen. Hallelujah. Peace of God be with you. God bless.